for South Florida with Jock Sanders and Tavon Austin deep to return. Both explosive and capable return men for the Mountaineers. Just about set to go. Underway, and it is Austin on the return. Looking for running room, couldn't find it. He'll be tripped up over his own feet at about the 20-yard line. You'll get your first look tonight at Geno Smith, the quarterback for the Mountaineers, and really a much more balanced attack than maybe many are accustomed to see.
Because of Geno Smith's ability throwing the football, I'd venture to say he's the best pure passer West Virginia has had at quarterback since the days of Mark Bulger. That's how good he is when it comes to throwing it downfield.
He is viewed as more of a facilitator, a distributor, and he's done that quite effectively in the early season. First snap of the night. Devine is number 7. He's in the backfield. Austin was there with him. Sanders, it's his hands on the football, and Doc Sanders, the senior, gets a short game. What about the impact players from West Virginia has it?
Noel Devine at running back, one of the most explosive players in the entire country, but he does have a toe injury. He's going to have to play through pain tonight.
You just saw Jock Sanders there and how in space, one-on-one, mighty hard to bring down. 33 straight games with a catch.
A second down and 6 for Geno Smith. Empty backfield. Smith has been very effective with 5 receiver formations. Sanders' second catch. Jock with some running room. He's got the first down of the night.
Great example there of what happens in space. You look at USF and Jesse, they are over there. They're in position to make the play, but there's just too much athleticism.
That defense tonight for USF is going to be under tremendous pressure to tackle tonight and really focus for 6 seconds at a time to get these playmakers down.
Devine in motion. Smith throws it again. 3 plays, 3 passes. That's a quick completion to his high school teammate, Stedman Bailey. And Bailey gets it out close to the first down marker.
You mentioned play and focus for 6 seconds at a time. You know, I understand that mentality, but don't you have to focus 60 minutes when you're playing West Virginia?
That's a lot of 6 seconds back to back to back, isn't it? Lots of focus, that mentality.
First running attempt of the night. It's Austin. Tavon Austin turning the corner. Very nearly took it before Jarrell Young was able to get him out of bounds.
Tavon Austin is listed as a wide receiver, but he played running back in high school, and he's a guy that they can line up outside, they can bring him in the backfield, they can do everything in their run game with him in the huddle.
Watch how fast he runs the arch. You see that arc, how he runs around that? I mean, it's just full speed the whole time.
And Austin's going to be the guy likely to take over at running back next year once Devine graduates. They're making sure they find ways in the meantime to get it to him this year, whether it's by passing or handing it to him. Play clock's getting deep. Smith confused, and he's going to use the timeout. I'm not sure if Geno was confused as much as maybe he just didn't get everybody aligned the way he wanted to. And after the positive plays, rather than take a chance, Smith uses his first timeout. West Virginia effective in its first drive of the night. Welcome back to Morgantown. First drive of the night for West Virginia. The Mountaineers have a first and 10 at the South Florida 39-yard line. And you see that this is a much more balanced attack, as we talked about in the open, almost the same in terms of ranking, rushing, and passing. West Virginia actually throwing for more yards per game than it is running for since 2005. The precise opposite has always been the case. Typically a top 10 type rushing team. The passing numbers below 100. Geno Smith, the biggest reason that's changed. Smith buying a little time and completes another one, and it's another first down for the Mountaineers. J.D. Woods making the grab.
This is what's called a two-play offense for West Virginia. Each and every play, Geno Smith has the ability to audible, and he's able to do that here when he saw South Florida was going to come with pressure.
And the wide receivers at West Virginia, if they're given 5 seconds, they will get open. You cannot cover them that long.
Smith doesn't run it off, and there is a noticeable difference than, say, a Pat White or Jarrett Brown.
This has been conventionally a more run-oriented team when Pat White was here. Geno Smith does have athleticism. He has the ability to move sticks with these legs, but he'd rather sit back in the pocket and throw it.
Devine is split out. At the moment, he's out of the game. He's been replaced in the lineup, and a five receiver set again for Geno Smith. Austin, little fly sweep look. Austin with a razor sharp cut gets it inside the 15, picks up the first down.
We've mentioned the balance of this West Virginia offense this year. When you're averaging 6.3 per play on first down, it really makes second down, the calls like this play right here, much easier.
It's so hard to game plan for this offense. Again, Tavon Austin is listed as a wide receiver. They got Brad Starks playing receiver, who's also played quarterback. They got different guys that can do different things each and every play.
Eighth play of the drive. Smith dumps it off, and Smith, who had been right on target all night, looking for Jock Sanders, it'll be second and 10.
This USF defense is a good defense. It's talented. And I think you're seeing right now they're really being pressed up and challenged on this field, and now as it gets shorter, it might be easier to cover.
This is the area where South Florida really shines on defense. In 13 red zone trips this year, they've only given up 6 touchdowns. They're the 14th best red zone defense in the entire country.
Devine has yet to touch it. Until now, Noel. His first carry is down close to the 10. D.D. Lattimore on the stop.
Noel Devine has that toe injury that really limited him last week against UNLV. He only had 3 carries in that game, but he ran for 84 yards and 2 touchdowns. He didn't practice a lot this week, and they're feeling him out to see how he goes.
Third down and 8. And West Virginia's been solid on third down this year, largely because they're so effective on first down, typically in shorter yardage situation. This one, smaller field, need to get it to about the 3. Smith put it on Noel Devine, and he couldn't hold it. And once again, as Jesse mentioned, the USF defense stiffens in the red zone.
Yeah, but against a good team. Now, against Florida earlier in the season, they were 4 for 4, Florida inside that red zone. So it's good to see them bow their neck when they get down here. USF's defense on third downs really been strong this season.
They match up great with West Virginia because of their speed. If anybody in this conference can run with all these playmakers of West Virginia, it is USF.
Tyler Bentoncourt will come on to attempt a 27-yard field goal. It's good initial height on the kick, so the short range usually not much of a problem. And it's not here. The first musket shot of the night, and the first points going to West Virginia as they take a 3-0 lead on their opening drive. Virginia defeating Pittsburgh 2-0. Really a shame they didn't play in this stadium, isn't it, Jesse?
When you think of the name of this stadium, Benvenuti al Stadio Milano Buscare. It feels like there should be a Serie A soccer game here between Inter, Juventus, AC Roma. You know, Totti would have loved to have played here in this stadium.
Milo Puskar, for whom the stadium is named, is a entrepreneur and philanthropist from the Morgantown area who's made sizable donations over the year to West Virginia. Despite the fact he is a Youngstown State graduate, West Virginia set to kick it off. Lindsey Lamar deep. Lamar from his 11. Lamar, who took one back 94 against Syracuse on Saturday, will do nothing of the sort this time around. Last year, B.J. Daniels absolutely torched West Virginia. He ran for over 100 yards and threw for 200 more and 3 touchdowns. He is a multi-dimensional threat.
You know, and it goes both ways. You know, I know they're trying to mold him into a little bit more of a quarterback that sits back there and throws down the field and only call his running plays 8 to 10 times a game. But he is what he is. His feet are what opens up the defense.
Daniels running the zone read on the first play and giving it to Mo Plancher. What about the impact players?
Wide receiver Dontavia Bogan is B.J. Daniels' go-to guy. He's going against a cornerback tonight in Keith Tandy that has given up a lot of long touchdown passes in his career.
All right, coaches say Samson Genus is the best overall offensive player on their team. Good luck tonight.
And good luck against Chris Neal, the nose man who is the anchor of that 3-3-5 defense. Those two guys, opportunities to play at the next level, will have a great battle in the middle tonight. Daniels, his first carry. Mountaineers after him. B.J. found a little bit of running room before he's chased out by Keith Tandy.
Number 30, J.T. Thomas, a linebacker at West Virginia, will be responsible tonight many times on spying B.J. Daniels. You saw right there how he came up to the line and pushed him out.
The USF off to a great start. They have to be good on first down tonight because they've been very bad on third down all season long. They have to stay ahead of the sticks.
Daniels moved the chains on his last run. Lamar up close to the 40-yard line.
USF had some injuries this past offseason at wide receiver with Sterling Griffin and A.J. Love, two guys that haven't played yet this year. So they were forced to take Lindsey Lamar, a former running back, put him at wide receiver, and you see they're trying to get him the football, make plays in space.
Also missed Carlton Mitchell, who left a year early for the NFL draft. He'd been looking for someone to stretch the field vertically, take advantage of Daniel's big arm. B.J. completes his pass to Dontavia Bogan, but the hat's off to the official near side, and Bogan appeared to have gone out of bounds before making the catch. The question is going to be, was he forced out? And from the officials, it appears that he was.
An example, there he is. He's out there. He's out. I don't know that he'd established
sure that he
body
back
position
in.
Back in to become a legal player.
Yeah, great point, Craig. So no stoppage and too late now. Plancher staying up and the whistle blows. Just to be clear on the rule, you can't go out of bounds and then. Okay, so they did get it stopped just in time to. To be clear on the rule, a receiver can't go out of bounds and come back in of his own volition and be a legal eligible receiver. However, if he's pushed out and returns immediately and establishes position, he can't catch the football.
On this play, there was press coverage with Brandon Hogan. They were playing a too high safety look with the safety coming over the top to double. You couldn't really see if he was pressed out of bounds at the point of attack. He certainly did come back in. The question is, was he out on his own before coming back in and making the catch?
Was he back in, though, and had made a presence back legally on
right.
the field before he made the catch? I think, you know, you're seeing, though, a composed as we start this football game, B.J. Daniels, yeah, that was a pocket throw right there. I mean, it's going to be interesting and kind of weird, if you will, looking at a quarterback that we normally see scrambling.
Well, last year when B.J. Daniels was playing, this was a shotgun team playing 5 wide receiver sets, but they had a lot of speed at wide receiver. They had a lot of ability, and they could allow B.J. Daniels to scramble around and make plays. South Florida does not have that speed this season at wide receiver. Reese just mentioned it. Carlton Mitchell is gone, so now they've had to rely more on their offensive line, be more conventional.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. First down for South Florida.
And take another look. And apparently, no indisputable video evidence. Now, you know, I tell you, I think he got both feet down before he caught it.
It's good in the NFL.
Yeah. So it's a nice play, good footwork by Dontavia Bogan, the senior out of Thomasville, Georgia, making the grab. And South Florida has a first and 10 from the West Virginia 46. Plancher, not much. Anthony Leonard on the stop.
An example of that 3-3-5 defense that is so hard to go against because you really don't know where the bodies are going to come from. It's always kind of a a rat in a hole. You don't know where they're going to come from with that corner or a linebacker filling a different lane.
Blanchard plowing down to about the 40-yard line. It'll bring up about third and 3.5. Robert Sands, Chris Neal on the stop.
South Florida establishing the run early. They're going to try to wear this defense down with Mo Plancher. Here's a defense that's only been giving up less than 3 yards per carry this season. But again, a very manageable third down here for USF.
As Jesse mentioned, USF among the worst in the nation at converting third down. Less than 30%. Quarterback draw. Daniels hit the backfield. Sidney Glover, the first man to get him, and JT Thomas alongside.
We won't circle any one particular player here or identify a West Virginia player other than watch the shield, watch the net, watch how aware they are of staying in their lanes and containment.
There's JT Thomas, like you said, Craig, spying on the quarterback, able to make the play. Bill Stewart, head coach, told us they expect BJ Daniels to run the football more tonight than he has earlier this year.
South Florida punting away, Brandon Hogan. Up and makes a nice play on the fair catch, and West Virginia will have it just inside its own 20. Mountaineers have a field goal. They'll try to get more when you come back.
Sunday night, who the real number one is, though, as they unveil the BCS standings.
BCS countdown show at 8:15 Eastern on ESPN. West Virginia for the second time tonight. Noel Devine gets up close to the 25.
Now, I'd venture to say this West Virginia offense has as much speed as anybody in the country. When you look at Tavon Austin, Jock Sanders, Noel Devine, take Oregon, take anybody you want in the country, they have as much quickness on this side of the ball.
Devine, Sanders, and Austin in many ways mirror images, and they found a way to use all three in the offense. Geno Smith will pull it down and run, get the first down and get down. Mountaineers move the chains.
And all of that speed that you're talking about, Jesse, is true, but it's the offensive line that goes with them. They work well together. They stay on. They're not getting beat up front. Very solid, not a deep offensive line, but solid offensive line.
And they returned 4 starters from last season.
Yeah.
On first and 10, Smith has a lot of freedom at the line of scrimmage to make run checks or change from run to pass, or vice versa. Keep it on the ground. And on the run and on the carry, D.D. Lattimore stopping Devine.
Geno Smith likes it when he can spread the field with multiple receivers. You look at his numbers, 4 receivers, completing 70% of his passes, 5 wides. He's only thrown 1 incompletion on the year. He can beat your coverages with his decision making. He's a true quarterback.
In 2nd and 8. Geno getting a little heat, and he'll just throw it away. Hot on his tail is Craig Marshall.
He's a true quarterback. There's an example of it, Jesse. And what you're meaning there is don't take a sack, move out of the pocket, avoid hit, just throw it away and live to play another down.
Offensive coordinator Jeff Mullen says he plays from the neck up. He's a very headsy player. But on the flip side, look at what USF's now been able to do. They've been able to force a bad play to set up a 3rd and long.
Because of first down success,
yeah.
Right? They stop them on first, don't allow that 6 yards.
Geno needs to get it up across the 42, goes to the 43 for the first down. Smith fires, complete. First down and more. J.D. Woods, his 2nd catch of the night. And the Mountaineers are in Bulls territory once again. We're getting a pretty good look at the pure passing ability of Smith.
You'll see J.D. Woods at the top of the screen. He's just going to run a 12-yard curl route. And look at his ability coming back to the ball. He puts himself between the ball and the defenders. Very well coached up on that route.
A pickup of 19. Devine has returned. Give to Devine. No Noel tries to get outside, and one of the reasons that South Florida has given West Virginia trouble the last few years, Bill Stewart told us yesterday, is that Florida speed, and Kayvon Webster showed some, to contain Devine.
And that has nothing to do with the turf toe or anything else. That's called containment, staying at home. USF's defense doing a nice job.
DJ Daniels here on the sideline. Looks like he has his fourth and fifth fingers taped together. May have jammed those on one of those run plays. We'll see how that affects him later in the game.
Here's the five receiver formation. Jesse just showed you, in which Smith has been deadly. Pressure. And again, he finds Woods along the sideline. A nifty move in the pocket, and then a good throw, and West Virginia turns a negative into a positive.
But a small positive, one that USF can live with. You know, a third and five coming up. Mark Snyder, defensive coordinator, changed it up, brought a corner off the top of the field. Picked up initially, but it still changed the rhythm of Geno Smith.
South Florida has to do a better job containing Smith with their pass rush. They got to keep him in the pocket.
Smith gets it off. Geno fires to Jock Sanders. Sanders, a great move. First down, Jock Sanders. Down to the 31-yard line. First and 10, Mountaineers.
You're going to see Jock Sanders, remember, who played running back in high school. He's here at the top of the screen. He's just going to work a little double move over the middle of the field, try to find an open spot for his quarterback to deliver him the football. Those running back instincts coming in favor for him.
But like a receiver, he felt the bracket on the inside, moved to the opening. And how about Geno Smith knowing where the receiver's going to go? Just outstanding execution.
Play action. Smith, wide open, touchdown, Bradley Starks. You like it if, say, I don't know, 80% of your catches on the season went for touchdowns?
Pretty efficient.
A lot.
That is Stark's fourth touchdown on five grabs. He is a guy that Bill Stewart called out after the LSU game, and he told him, it's time for you to step up and make some plays. He has in the last couple, and he has the first touchdown of the night. Bittencourt for the extra point. West Virginia's had it twice, and they've scored twice.
Now, this is what Mark Snyder feared, having to defend vertical and horizontal. Play action pass, all the white jerseys come up to defend, and it opens up the big one.
That stock post wide open to the former quarterback, Brad Starks. Geno Smith liking it early.
And, well, he should. West Virginia up by 10. Bradley Starks has hauled in a 31-yard touchdown strike from Geno Smith. Starks' fourth touchdown catch of the year. He only has five catches all season. The first three touchdowns coming in the last game against UNLV. And Smith, once again, most efficient. 4 of 5 for 66 yards in the touch. He's 8 of 11 for 105 yards in the first quarter tonight. Corey Smith's kickoff drives Lindsey Lamar to his goal line. Lamar's got wheels. Almost broke it back. Sydney Glover saving the touchdown as we check in with Jen Brown.
Thanks. I've got a quick injury update on B.J. Daniels. We saw him getting his hand taped up over there on the sideline. I talked to Steve Waltz, the head trainer. They said he did only jam his finger. It's not broken. They're taping it up, and he's going to be back into play.
It's certainly great news for the Bulls, Jen, because one of the reasons that Skip Holtz have wanted to limit B.J.'s running attempts this year is simply they don't have any experience behind Daniels at the quarterback position.
How about that, Grant? Don't forget about that name, Lindsey Lamar, number 5. They want to get more touches for him today, not just kick returns, but offensively.
Option. There is a touch for him, and he's touched rudely in the backfield by a host of Mountaineers. Najee Good, the first one to get there.
In this 3-3-5 stack scheme, West Virginia is basically playing with six defensive backs on the field. In my eyes, it's the perfect defense when you're playing against good athletes on offense like a B.J. Daniels or like a Lindsay Lamar, because you have so much speed. Guys can run and chase these guys in the backfield.
Second and 16. Daniels, Plancher is behind him. He made a good catch, but nowhere to run. It'll be third and long for the Bulls.
Jesse, it's almost like, Reese, you'll know this in basketball terms, it's almost like having 5 point guards going against 5 point guards. Everybody can cover everybody, right? And an open space right there. You saw four yellow jerseys around one receiver.
On third and long, this is where West Virginia wants you defensively. They're going to rush three players, play a big zone, keep all of your routes in front of them so they can tackle.
Bottom of the screen, keep your eye on Bruce Irvin, a pass rushing specialist with great speed. Daniels taking a shot. Bogan's out there, and he's going to draw a pass interference call against Brandon Hogan. Now, USF will do this.
15-yard penalty, first down.
West Virginia coaches expected this, and South Florida makes no secret of it. They're going to take some shots.
They're going to try to isolate Dontavia Bogan at the bottom of the screen and line him up with smaller cornerbacks on downfield routes. On this play, B.J. Daniels just taking a shot, trying to give his receiver a chance. There's some inadvertent contact here made. There's some hand swiping. Pushes him out of bounds. That is pass interference, although Bill Stewart not going to like it.
Bill might be shaking his head at Brandon. So a first and 10 for the Bulls. Daniels. A short gain. Hogan there to run him out of bounds.
Just really impressed when you watch the discipline of this 3-3-5 defense and watch how everybody goes to their assignments. There's somebody waiting in every lane. Corner comes up, he's got containment. Nowhere to go. Just real discipline.
Defense of Jeff Castile is the coordinator that Bill Stewart calls the best kept secret in college football. Second and six facing B.J. Daniels. Quarterback draw. Daniels inside the 20 and showing those wheels that have bedeviled the Mountaineers. In the last meeting, he went for over 100 yards on the ground. Ran for over 100 yards early this year against Florida, and maybe that's the key for USF to stay in the game as we come to the end of the first quarter, West Virginia by 10. Outside the West Virginia Coliseum, the logo. Jerry West, who took the Mountaineers to the 1959 Final Four, almost won a national championship for them, 1 point loss to Cal. And Bob Huggins, who last year took the Mountaineers to the Final Four before falling to eventual national champion Duke. People here in Morgantown, very grateful.
When did last year he had that real memorable moment of being a coach, loving a great player on the court going down with an injury?
That's right, Deshaun Butler went down and Huggins is out there, an indelible image. And here is B.J. Daniels, something that the Mountaineers have been unable to erase from their memory bank is him running wild last year. They've contained him so far.
South Florida has to take advantage of these opportunities inside the red zone. Last week in a loss against Syracuse, they made it inside the Syracuse 40-yard line six times. They only came away with 3 points.
West Virginia keeps making those kind of plays and staying at home, being disciplined like they are. B.J. Daniels will get frustrated, and that's when he makes mistakes.
Couple in the red zone last week against the Orange. On the roll, B.J. is outside the tackle box and threw it up for grabs and didn't get out of bounds. Anthony Leonard was applying the pressure, the senior from McKeesport, Pennsylvania.
That's one of those throw-ups I'm talking about right there. Don't get it quite enough, out of bounds, frustrated.
B.J. Daniels has thrown a lot of interceptions this year, forcing passes into coverage. He's shown his immaturity. He's got to be mature here. It's touchdown or check down or throw it away. A field goal's okay.
Third and nine. Pressure. Daniels does, just flipping a short pass to Mo Plancher. Bruce Irvin, pass rushing specialist, was back there chasing B.J., and the Bulls will try to get on the board with a field goal, and that has been no certain thing for USF this year. And we'll start with Maikon Bonani. He is 3 of 4 in field goals this year. He and Eric Schwartz have sort of gone back and forth to place kicking duties. This one's going to be from 36 yards out. Bonani to get USF on the board, and he does. So South Florida's drive pays off in points. Back to within a touchdown for Skip Holtz. 10-3, West Virginia with the lead.
Back to Owen Schmidt years.
Oh, you know, just tape the forehead up so you hit somebody.
Owen used to hit himself in the head without a helmet with his helmet, didn't he?
Yeah.
Tavon Austin. Tripped up just inside the 25 as we go to the studio and check.
Like each other. Mm-hmm. I mean, they all have almost the same skill sets. They're all fast. They're all quick. They can all catch. They can all take handoffs.
They got another guy named a true freshman, Trey Johnson, number 27. We'll see him later on. He came in. He looks like them.
Where do they get them from?
Florida, mostly. Yeah. But they found Austin in Maryland. They've recruited very well in Florida over the last several years. Also in the Tidewater area of Virginia, has been a fertile place for Mountaineers. Smith, one of those guys underneath. Talk to Sanders. Sanders, not a lot of running room this time.
You're going to see this USF defense really change their looks, but you saw the breaking down of the leverage on the way he tackled Sanders. You just can't go running out there and throw a one-time shot and miss.
Devine in the backfield with Smith. You know, underneath, it's in the air a while off the tip. Starks, who caught the touchdown pass, who couldn't hang on to the high pass.
You got to be very careful as a quarterback when you're throwing the football over the middle of the field. You have to keep it down. You have to hit your receiver in the numbers or lower. If you throw it high and you throw it hard, those balls get tipped. Then you're looking at an interception. And here's West Virginia again, forced into a third and long.
And USF, a good third down defense, allowing your opponents only 32% conversion.
Austin's return to the game. He's in the slot at the top of your screen. Geno Smith signaling to his receivers. Smith looking for Austin on third down. Two couldn't connect. From South Florida with a good defense, Curtis Witherspoon on the coverage.
You're going to see Mistral Raymond. They call him skinny on the inside here at the slot, number 13. They've really missed his physicality at the corner position. He's tall at 6'2". He's very long. He can press receivers at the point of attack and stay locked on. Nice job there contending for that ball.
So the Mountaineers will have to punt it away. Greg Pugnetti. Deep to return is Terrence Mitchell. Mitchell won't be able to get to it. Mountaineers are going to let it roll inside South Florida 30. So after the field goal drive, the defense comes up with a stop, and now the Bulls with a chance to drive for the Tide. 10-3, West Virginia. Was really slowed down for the first time tonight. Just punted it away. Tavon Austin, who was banged up on a kickoff return, riding the bike trying to stay loose. And South Florida's going to have it at the 34 after officials ruled that's where the West Virginia punt coverage team touched it first. So a first and 10 for B.J. Daniels. Daniels to Evan Landy. Landy with his first catch of the night, and he gets across the 40-yard line. You know, Skip Holtz is in his first year as the head coach at USF after taking over for the only football coach South Florida had ever had in Jim Leavitt. the end of last season, Levitt was dismissed amidst accusations that he'd had a physical confrontation with a player in the locker room, charges that Levitt has opposed. Holtz, after winning Conference USA in consecutive years at East Carolina in his first season at South Florida. Big time run up the middle by Marcus Shaw, but a flag coming in late as Shaw got up close to midfield. You know, one of the things we watch for, the call.
Holding. 55 offense. 10-yard penalty. Second down.
That'll be against Jeremiah Warren, who starts at left guard for the Bulls. But when Holtz came into this situation after the dismissal of Levitt, what he found in many instances was a team divided along the lines of people who really, I guess, supported what the allegations were against Levitt in the locker room in that game against Louisville, and those who were upset that the coach had been left, had been dismissed. So he had a lot of work to do in terms of trying to bring this team together and make them a unit. And so far, they've made some progress, certainly on the defensive side of the ball. And an explosive quarterback who's throwing over the middle, and Daniels, and it's incomplete. But Holtz has been able to really make this team one unit as opposed to an offense against defensive mentality, which it had at times in the past.
And he said to us that he thought this would be a game where he could feel and see where they have come and how far along he's come with bringing that team together and the unity. It's a double-edged deal. He had to get the team together, and then he had to implement a system which is really different now, especially for their quarterback, B.J. Daniels.
And B.J. told us the terminology is certainly part of the difference, but the approach also has been a little bit different for him. On third down, Daniels using his feet, throwing it, trying to squeeze it into tight coverage to Landy. Ian Smith was all over the Bulls receiver in South Florida. We'll have to punt it away.
Here was a play where I thought B.J. Daniels had a throw over the middle of the field, right at where the first down marker would have been. He got a little impatient, scrambled out early, and the play broke down on him. He's got to be a little more patient.
But even at the breakdown point, you saw how athletic he was to be able to get his hips back and throw that ball.
Justin Brockhouse, Brandon Hogan will make the fair catch just inside the 25-yard line. And now for tonight's weekend menu, brought to you by Applebee's. Headliner on ESPN, number one Ohio State going to Camp Randall.
It'll be a great test for the number one Buckeyes. You know, their defense has not allowed a 100-yard rusher in 29 consecutive games, but they have yet to see this year a rushing attack from John Clay, James White, like they're going to see over at Camp Randall.
And an efficient quarterback in Scott Tolzien, who will take advantage if a defense that gets up too hard to stop the run. Very balanced, good team.
Michigan, after losing to Michigan State, has to deal with a stout defense of the Hawkeyes. Geno Smith, Doc Sanders. Sanders is immediately slammed to the turf by John Legist.
One thing this South Florida defense has is a lot of athleticism and speed, and this is a defense that wants to be one of the best in the nation. They aspire to be a top 10 defense. Defensive coordinator Mark Snyder really has put that pressure on them to be great week in, week out.
Snyder, the former head coach at Marshall here in the state of West Virginia, and also defensive coordinator, put together some of the great Ohio State defenses, A.J. Hawk and company. See a lot of zone blitzes in a Mark Snyder scheme. South Florida trying to show one now. Smith to Austin. He's hit immediately by Quentin Washington.
You know, and following up on Mark Snyder, he said in 09 he went back and looked at all the top 20 defenses, and he compiled their numbers, and he wanted to try to match those because that's what they're looking to do, like you said, Jesse, to be a top 20 defense. And the one that I'm liking this year so far, scoring defense, only 16 points.
Keep in mind, they played Stony Brook, Western Kentucky, and FAU. Those are the three wins so far.
Don't mess up a good graphic with a fact.
Sorry.
His turn to rain on your parade. I usually do that. Third down. Sanders. Coming back across the field. He doesn't make it to the first down marker, but that's what a guy like Jock Sanders can do for you. I'm not sure that's exactly how they had it drawn up, but Sanders can find creases.
But that's that speed of the defense USF has to recover, because initially I thought, watch out, jailbreak, here it goes.
That's the biggest reason why this West Virginia offense has not scored more than 19 points in any of the last four contests. For whatever reason, and we think it's the speed, South Florida just matches up perfectly with West Virginia.
You know, I told Mark Snyder that stat before the game, and he looked at me and said, really? He said, thanks for putting the heat on me. Punt away. Mitchell. Not a lot of running room for Terrence Mitchell, but B.J. Daniels and the Bulls will have it back. A 10-3 game in the Big East opener for West Virginia. ABC College Football presented by Buffalo Wild Wings and ABC or ESPN at 3:30. Lindsey Lamar has it, and they try to get him to the outside unsuccessfully for the most part again on first down.
You know, a lot of people would look at what USF is trying to do on offense with B.J. Daniels, trying to make him a more pocket passer. And I think people think they're taking a square peg, trying to fit into a round hole, you know, and saying, hey, just let's spread the field, let him get in the shotgun and run around. But the coaching staff really believes that they're building an offense around what they think B.J. Daniels does well.
What B.J. would like to do here is move those chains on the give to Plancher, and he does just that. Good read as Mo breaks it up to about the 44.
Watch the top of the screen, the right side of the offensive line. Watch out here how the man stays at home. Defensive end stays at home. Why? Because of the threat of B.J. Daniels running the ball. That little pause allowed the runner to get up the field.
This time Daniels throws it. Lamar makes one guy miss, and Lindsey Lamar showing those fleet feet. Flag appeared to come in late.
Hold it. 81 offense. 10-yard penalty. First down.
So Dontavia Bogan trying to block for his buddy on the quick pass. A little bit too much of the Mountaineer.
I got to say, just watching this, B.J. Daniels to me looks a lot more comfortable in the shotgun tonight. It's where it looks like he's more natural doing. Here you see Bogan at the top of the screen, just pulling some cloth there. He's got both shoulder pads. Referee's going to call that every time. But this offense wants B.J. Daniels to play more under center. They want to be more multiple, but right now using a lot of shotgun, and it's helping this offense.
Square peg, round hole.
Square or round, he went down in the backfield. Najee Good going to pull down B.J. Daniels, and you see how much South Florida really relies on B.J. Daniels this year. He's been outstanding. Granted, the wins have come against lesser competition, but the numbers have been terrific. The two losses, Florida and Syracuse, the numbers have been horrific. Primarily the one Craig just circled, the six interceptions and two losses. He has seven for the year against only four touchdown passes. So after the sack, Daniels looking at a second and 17. Mountaineers showing everybody's coming, and they do. Daniels escapes all of them before he's finally chased down. That was Pat Lazier who got back there first and eventually was in on the tackle, but not before B.J. made positive yardage.
This West Virginia defense is very coached up. Jeff Castile has done a good job in preparation this week. As soon as South Florida went to an empty set, the defense called off the coverage, and they came after B.J. Daniels with a cover zero blitz look.
There's a reason they're number one in the Big East in total defense, number seven in the country. They want to be number one in the country.
We've talked about USF struggles on third down. They've yet to convert one tonight. They need to pick up 10 here. Daniels, Plancher. He won't get there. Brandon Hogan, Robert Sands, both on the stop.
And just smart. You know what? You got third and long, and you rush three, and you drop everybody back, and you understand that you're going to force the ball out for a 3 or 4 yard gain, and that's it.
Field position is okay. A punt is okay here.
Hogan signals for the fair catch, and he'll make it at about his 10-yard line. Now let's take a look at this week's projected BCS standings brought to you by Allstate. This according to ESPN's Brad Edwards, and as we documented on our BCS countdown show, Brad has the entire formula save one computer, so these likely reflect what you would see at this moment. Obviously, the games to be played this weekend will affect it.
I'm not surprised by Boise State being number one after 6 weeks, considering they basically went on the road and played Virginia Tech and then beat Oregon State at home. I'm surprised at number five, Ohio State. That's one I think shocks a lot of people right now.
Buckeyes 10th in the computers, with the tough part of their schedule coming up starting Saturday night in Madison. Devine picks up about one. And Ohio State is number one in both polls, and as I'm sure most know, two-thirds of the BCS formula are the polls, the coaches poll and the Harris poll, and the polls will help Ohio State, and the computer's hurting them at the moment.
Schedule will help all of those schools down below, the LSU, Nebraska, Auburn, Alabama, as these teams begin to get into their games and Boise State gets away from competition, you start seeing the shuffle.
Geno Smith then throwing a little screen. Jock Sanders, and a lot of the screen passes in West Virginia run strictly based on what Geno Smith sees from the defense.
Yeah, he can audible at any point. He can pull it in the run game. But right there you saw Jaquan Williams and his ability. He chased, was in the backfield trying to shut down the run, then ran all the way back out to the perimeter to make the tackle. Incredible speed.
Isn't that effort? I mean, you're sitting there watching this guy that's chasing the quarterback. He's in the flat. That's how you stop shifty mobile runners or receivers.
Austin with the catch. He is knocked down quickly by Mr. Raymond. It'll be a three and out for the Bulls.
Like you said, Reese, these defenses have kind of figured out how to be soft but fast to the ball.
There hasn't been a lot of shots downfield yet from West Virginia either, with the exception of the touchdown pass. West Virginia right now trying to feel their way offensively. It's almost as if they're afraid of the pass rush from USF.
And Stu told us he wanted to push the ball deep tonight.
Bill Stewart has been looking at that. Jeff Mullen was concerned about the interior of his defensive line and afraid that perhaps might be a difficult matchup for them. Mitchell bobbled it briefly, but able to haul it in. South Florida will have it back. Well, with a win in California, Tony Stewart has emerged as a championship contender. He has his sights set on current points leader Jimmy Johnson. Chase goes under the lights in Charlotte. The chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues. Bank of America 500 is Charlotte on ABC Saturday at 7:30 Eastern time. Start things with NASCAR countdown at 7 Eastern. So Jimmy Johnson going for five in a row, still holding that lead. But now Stewart is within striking distance, along with Jeff Gordon, Kevin Harvick, and Denny Hamlin.
It's a countdown to everything, isn't there?
Build anticipation and drama. Correct.
And here's the point of, it's okay to punt. You're back to the same field position. Your defense did their job.
Blanchard on the zone read. Justin Cross into West Virginia territory.
And to your point, Craig, if you're USF here, you'd love to get points out of this somehow. This is the second drive in a row now. You've accepted the football at midfield. Now you got to make it work.
And the fact that this crowd's really no impact, has no influence on this game in USF. So the longer that they're in it, the more comfortable USF becomes running their offense.
To the 9-yard pickup. Second and one. See if South Florida takes a shot. And keep it on the ground. Blanchard to the 45.
Mo Plancher is only 5'8", 195 pounds, but for a little guy, he's a bruising runner. He can wear defenses down to help this offense out later in the game. For such a small stature, he's a guy that's gotten a big workload early in this game.
Jesse, you talked about earlier the problems that Skip Holtz and his staff have had at wide receiver. They also had some defections at running back, too. Dismissal of Mike Ford, who was a big, physical, talented back, but had some off-the-field issues. Jamar Taylor, he's also played some left the program. Blanchard carrying the bulk of the running load. Short gain there, maybe no gain.
That's a kind of a soft look that as a running back you think, hey, this is going to be kind of easy because there are only three defensive linemen and three. And you see how, watch the linebacker level, how they attack the ball down the hill to the ball carrier. Soft but aggressive.
Bulls could use a little aggression on second down. Daniels, second catch of the night for Bogan. Bogan trying to work his way. Football might have come out at the end. Officials going in to try to sort it out. South Florida, it appears, is going to retain possession, though it is Terrence Garvin who emerges with the football.
This is something Bill Stewart's really upset about so far. They work so much on fumbles and stripping in practice, and they've had a lot of opportunities this year as a defense to pick up loose balls. For whatever reason, they have not been able to do that. Montavia Bogan on the spin move, the ball comes out on the player's leg, and I think they're going to take a look at this.
I think what the official on the field has ruled is, you see, the ball, I believe, is out, but Bogan immediately gets it back. And I think what the official saw is that he has possession on the bottom of the pile there. But they'll send it upstairs. Our replay official tonight is Jack Kramer. Jack will have a look at it and make sure that everything's in working order.
Coach Stewart's, you know, he's okay with the interceptions that they're doing, but just when a ball's on the ground, it just goes in spurts. Sometimes these defenses, they're always around it. They pick it up, but you just hit dry spells.
You know, last week we had Nebraska, and we talked about the number of times the Cornhuskers had put the ball on the ground, yet they really hadn't, I mean, they had lost some, but relatively speaking, they hadn't lost a lot.
After further review, the play stands. Third down.
We'll inject a little life into the Mountaineer crowd, but at least from my perspective, I thought they got it right. I thought Bogan had recovered the football and was on the bottom of the pile. Yeah, but clearly a fumble beforehand. Still a frustration for Bill Stewart, perhaps an opportunity to force a turnover. Instead, it'll be third and short for USF.
As long as the offensive line can clearly identify who they're going to block with this 3-3-5 look prior to the snap and short yardage goal line, you got a good chance.
Daniels will keep it himself, and that's the danger of doing it in the shotgun. Anthony Leonard in the backfield.
You can't allow the running back to go up in there. Watch the running back miss his block, Plancher. Okay, he misses the linebacker and goes to the next level. That's his guy.
And after the loss, it'll be a 4th and 3 as West Virginia's defense comes up with a big play. After the loss, West Virginia's defense, Anthony Leonard making a play on B.J. Daniels in the backfield. Under 2 minutes to go, Skip Holtz is going to punt it away rather than risk giving West Virginia excellent field position for a late drive in the half. Punt, a beautiful one, is going to be touched dead just inside the 10-yard line as we go back to the studio and check in with John Thomas.
Well, Reese, coming up on the IBM Halftime Report, Mack Brown, the head coach of Texas, will join us as he gets ready for Nebraska. Number one Ohio State prepares for Wisconsin. And the May Day Minute, which Reese, as you know, is nowhere near 60 seconds. Back to you.
Dr. Lou, now we've got the May Day Minute.
I think Mark is like the anti-Les Miles. You know, his clock runs a lot longer, stretches out the time, expands the minute. So 1:43 to go. We'll see how West Virginia manages the clock with only a timeout to go and just over 90 yards away from the end zone. Geno Smith going to take a shot. He's got a man wide open. Stedman Bailey. That'll get you out of the hole, and now West Virginia has the clock stopped to move the chains in a big game.
I'm not sure why USF at the line of scrimmage goes hard and goes man-to-man down here, opening up the opportunity for the big ball.
Cornerback Quentin Washington fell down on the play.
Devine gets out of bounds.
You're going to see Quentin Washington right here. He gets jammed up with the receiver. He tries to get into a backpedal and falls down. The safety ran to the middle of the field, and that allowed for the wide open completion.
Wow.
Darrell Young alertly coming over. Stedman might have taken it all the way. Second down and 9. Smith complete. His tight end Will Johnson has it. He is short of the first down to bring up a third down, but he does get the clock stopped.
use the word tight end in this offense. That's finally coming back around in vogue where you can call a tight end and put him in the game here.
Now, Will's a former wide receiver, flexes out a little bit. Normal tight end Tyler Urban's been injured, and Johnson's done a good job. Smith started to throw, pulled it down, and he'll be sacked. West Virginia has one timeout left. It's Terrell McClain back there to stop him.
Terrell McClain is a guy that this team, they have a nickname for him. They call him the Dancing Bear. At 6'3", 310 pounds, he is very active. You see Skip Holtz running out of the field. He's going to make sure he gets a timeout to potentially get a chance with the football back here to make a drive.
They call Terrell McClain the Dancing Bear on that defense. We may have to call him Dancing Skipper.
He showed better lateral quickness than he ever did as a player at Notre Dame.
His daddy couldn't have run that fast out there.
His dad would have put the official in the headlock once he got there. Storylines in week 7. The Ohio State University ranked number 1 for the first time since the final regular season AP poll. We'll see how long it lasts when they go to Camp Randall. And then South Carolina, you know, Steve Spurrier has said for a while, are we going to be same old South Carolina? We'll find out when they have to go to Kentucky.
Steve Spurrier has never lost to Kentucky, but now they have to try to, you know, contain that success early. Derek Lockett, running back for Kentucky, not expected to play in that football game.
And they have the BCS Countdown Show at 8:15 Eastern on ESPN, where you will see the exclusive unveiling of the first BCS standings of the season. Continue the show on ESPNU at 9 o'clock Eastern time.
Very impressed with South Florida's defense now in the last 4 possessions. They've been dominating.
West Virginia, after the big play on first down, got nothing afterwards. And now the punt makes a very fortuitous bounce for West Virginia. And if South Florida wants to make a little run at it, they'll start from their own 14-yard line. Hey, you know, guys, here's a situation. As we were talking to Skip Holtz earlier this week about his quarterback, B.J. Daniels, they had a game against Florida down in the Swamp, had the lead late in the half, and they were in a somewhat similar situation. Skip said, I thought, hey, we'll call a screen. If we get it, we'll get a little something going. You know, if not, we'll just run the half out. And B.J. threw an interception and ended up setting up a Florida touchdown.
You're a young quarterback. You have to realize, sir, you have a long way to go just to get in field goal range. You do have 2 timeouts left, but you do not start forcing throws, trying to make superhuman plays here. It's okay if you go into the tunnel 10-3 down at half.
Daniels throwing in right on cue. It's intercepted. Robert Sands with the pick. An egregious error by the sophomore quarterback.
B.J. Daniels, when he breaks the pocket, the receiver's open. It's the right thought. It's the late, tardy throw. And Sands explodes on the ball, makes the play, comes up with something that B.J. Daniels just can't do these things when he just doesn't understand the clock.
Robert Sands had 5 interceptions a year ago. One of the reasons a lot of pro scouts think he's one of the best prospects at the safety position this year.
Smith gets it away before the pressure. A little hook and lateral. Jock Sanders gave it to Devine. Touchdown. That is a devastating 2-play sequence for South Florida on the road. Load up that musket. And just before the half, the turnover. The creative play call from offensive coordinator Jeff Mullen. The extra point. And what looked like a 7-point game at the break is going to turn into a 14-point edge with 34 seconds left.
USF defensive coordinator Mark Snyder told us he thought his defense was very good in sudden change situations. Obviously, he's not expecting a hook and ladder right off the interception. Ball comes out of Geno Smith's hands. And this is just perfectly executed. They throw it out to Jock Sanders, able to flip to Noel Devine, speed to speed, tightrope the sidelines. And what should have been 10-3 at halftime, now all of a sudden 17-3 West Virginia.
I think with that running right there, that you saw that the toe that was a concern mildly for Noel Devine is not an issue. He turned the corner with plenty of power pushing from those feet.
Two best buddies operating that hook and lateral, Sanders and Devine, who both came back for their senior seasons, liking themselves in some ways to superheroes. Sanders, Batman, Devine, Superman. There's been a legion of doom for South Florida in the last two plays. Celebrating in Morgantown after the touchdown have ignited this crowd. Now Ford on the short sky kickoff. Andreas Shields, the tight end, gives a good field position.
We go back to that touchdown. You're going to see Jock Sanders in the slot. He's just going to be running a little curl route here at the top. Here he is in the slot, little curl route. They're going to bring Noel Devine around on the pitch. Just get it to the outside, and it's an easy touchdown. Very, very well-designed play by Jeff Malm, the offensive coordinator. The timing was absolutely perfect.
Not to mention the blocking from the inside coming out to block, and it's just, you know, the execution of it, the sudden change. And as Mark Snyder told us, he says, you know, we work on it in practice all the time. All of a sudden, we'll holler sudden change, and you jump down there, and you try to be prepared for it. But I think it just shocked him. It was so sudden. The interception by Daniels, there's just no way you can regather after you played so well defensively in the second quarter.
You know, I think B.J. Daniels' biggest weakness right now is the fact that he believes he can make every play. And I agree with you on that last play, Craig, that the throw was there to be made. But at the same time, you know, smart quarterbacks understand situations and the situation of the game that they're in. You know, and that would have taken a perfect throw to complete downfield. Maybe that's one next game he gets in that spot he decides to just throw away. But these are the growing pains that head coach Skip Holtz is going to have to go through with a very raw, untested quarterback.
So the flag on the kickoff, it was offsetting personal fouls. So South Florida take another chance just before halftime. Daniels holds on to it this time, and he's sacked. Najee Good in the backfield again.
You know, the long-term damage from a throw like that is you get a quarterback now who gets back there and becomes conservative. And, you know, now you're all of a sudden down 17-3, and the last thing you can be is conservative.
A couple of sacks for West Virginia. Daniels has been contained in the running game. A costly turnover just before the half, and West Virginia is up 17-3 as we check in with Jen Brown.
Coach, a momentum swing right there at the end, the interception that leads to a touchdown. What do you say to your kids at the half?
Well, I mean, they're playing hard. They're playing hard on both sides of the ball. Offensively, we've had two drives stopped with penalties that have kind of hurt us and put us behind the chains, but they're playing hard on both sides of the ball. They're weathering the storm. I just hate this in the end. Tried to call something safe out on the perimeter, and BJ started scrambling, and when that happens, a lot of things can happen. I hate it. We just got to come back, and we got to earn it back in the second half. We start with the ball.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
So Skip Holtz will try to rally his team at halftime. A difficult place to play in Morgantown, and the Mountaineers will go hook and lateral up 17-3 as we now join Mark May, Lou Holtz, and John Saunders for the IBM Halftime Report. Morgantown, West Virginia got a late touchdown at the end of the first half to push its lead against South Florida out to 17-3 as we get set to start in the second half. Here are the first half statistics. South Florida, a slightly better job on the ground, but the passing edge was huge for West Virginia, and the one turnover was enormous as it led to West Virginia's second touchdown. Reese Davis, Craig James, Jesse Palmer, Jen Brown working down on the sideline. So, devastating thing emotionally for South Florida. What do you expect to see from them early in the second half?
USF had less than 100 yards offense in the first half. They've got to realize and respect that West Virginia's defense can run. They cannot go into a shell. I mean, if they go into a shell, they won't get 100 yards in the second half.
If I'm Skip Holtz calling plays, I wouldn't change a whole lot. My defense right now is playing so well, shutting down a lot of playmakers from West Virginia. Offensively, the only difference was that huge interception at the end of the half.
It seemed the most effective thing that South Florida did on offense was run the zone read and leave it with Mo Plancher. Maybe see a little more of that in the second half. And South Florida will have it first to start the second half as Corey Smith gets set to kick it away in front of the fans who have been a little quiet for much of the night. The second half is under the way, but a little fired up with the late touchdown as the ball will bound through the end zone and South Florida will take it on the 20. Let's take a look at our coaching adjustments brought to you by the Home Depot.
Well, USF is 0 for 5 right now on third down in the first half. They set themselves up into position to convert some of these plays, but they haven't been able to execute, Craig, when they've gotten that critical down.
I thought this was critical. Going in, they just had the good job turning it back from the defense on third and short. They missed the block on the linebacker. They punt, which led to, ultimately, a big play on the other end. They just can't convert third down.
One thing that would help that is being successful on first down, which is what DJ Daniels has to start the third quarter. Daniels complete to Dontavia Bogan as we check in with Jen Brown.
I talked to Coach Stewart out of the half. He said he felt like his team did a good job leveraging the ball in the first half. He said he realizes how good Daniels and his receivers are, that if his guys can keep on leveraging the ball and attacking on defense, he thinks he can pull out a victory tonight, Reese.
All right, Jen, and keeping leverage against B.J. Daniels was something that West Virginia did not do successfully last year when he ran for over 100 yards. Daniels completes the pass. Lindsey Lamar. Lamar will be a little bit short of the first down. Ian Smith on the stop.
You know, going back to what you said, Reese, they've had a lot of success running the football against soft six-man boxes. You see here, quick completions to set up yet another very manageable third down, but they got to execute now, Craig.
So they're 0 for 5 coming in. Now here they are at sixth time at third and short. And coming into the season, terrible offensively third down team, 30% only. So it's a continuing habit that's not good.
Quick pass to Evan Landy. Landy was hit quickly but fell forward. The officials coming across the way. They're going to mark it right on the 30. And if so, if they do mark it right on the 30, that should be the first enough for the first down. And it is.
Now, what did they do differently there? They went under center on third and short. Get under the center, change the look. It's just a better short yardage goal line play.
And a heads up play by the quarterback to spit it out to a 6'3" wide receiver. Just let him go get the 2 yards.
The first third down conversion of the night for the Bulls. Daniels again to Bogan. Bogan with a pickup of about 6.
I love the play calling here early in the second half by offensive coordinator Todd Fitch. Your young quarterback just threw a brutal interception late in the first half. Four easy completions now to start the second half to get his confidence back and going.
I wanted to see the body language. And B.J. Daniels is throwing it with aggression. He's not going to go into a shell.
Blanchard, first down, and Moe gets it across the 45, and he very nearly had a whole lot more.
This USF offense feels like their offensive line is the strength, the combined 91 starts for the unit up front, and look at the push and the lane they're able to create for Moe Blanchard.
Yeah, Chaz Hines, 79, that right guard, he came down on the tackle and then sealed the linebacker and gave a really nice running lane.
First and 10. Blanchard pushing up close to the 50-yard line, and South Florida is looking for its first offensive touchdown in more than 6 quarters.
That's a long time, Reese. Hey, Reese, don't you? But you can feel it, can't you?
Yeah.
A little bit more of a blue-collar mentality coming out here in this drive.
But this is the offense that Skip Holt had envisioned. B.J. Daniels under center, fullback, tight end on the field. Not the spread look they had last year.
Play action. Wide open Bogan, his fifth catch of the night. Bogan's still on his feet, down to the 35, and he picks up the first down, and the Bulls are on the move.
And it starts with the formation. What a lot of people call four-eye right. You got a tight end to the right-hand side of the offensive line. Fullback offset to the left. Play action. Gets out quickly delivering the ball.
Todd Fish, the offensive coordinator, moving the pocket, allowing B.J. Daniels to get outside. So this West Virginia defense can't just pin their ears back and try to attack him behind center.
Quick pass. Complete. Very short game. T.J. Knowles making his first grab of the night. Keith Tandy on the stop.
Have we seen a deep ball thrown down the field?
For South Florida?
Right.
We have one time. They had a pass interference call.
One time.
Yeah.
Okay. Because they're playing in a box here lately.
Yeah.
All right.
Dontavia Bogan's going to be the guy they try to take shots with if they're going to go downfield.
There he is down here.
No, keep it on the ground instead. Plancher gets inside the 30. It'll bring up a third down.
You see how effective this offense is on the opening drive of the second half. Conventional runs under center, quick throws to the perimeter, setting up third and five and less.
Sets up third and fourth down. I'm going for it here. I'm getting a first down offensively.
So how does that impact the play calling? You want to run it twice here? What are you looking for?
They've been good with that little zone read that you mentioned coming out. Now they're under center. Just change the complexion of the West Virginia defensive front.
It's another six-man box, soft against the run.
They'll throw it instead. Ball's batted into the air and very nearly intercepted on the deflection. It'll be fourth down.
I would have run the ball. This just here, the receiver got it. He's trying to go to the first down marker, right, Jesse? And then turn around, and Daniels rushed it.
And remember, Lindsey Lamar is a converted running back. He doesn't yet have the ball skills as a receiver to be able to turn around, locate a low football. You got to be very careful as a quarterback. You have to be accurate from those type of receivers.
Maikon Bonani will line up from 47. Career long of 49, and this one is good. So USF turns its opening drive of the second half into points as BJ Daniels and the Bulls hanging in Morgantown.
College football in high definition is presented by Vizio.
Maikon Bonani just knocked through a field goal for South Florida. Bulls trim that deficit to 11 at 17-6. The new number one team in the land, the Ohio State University, led by Terrell Pryor, going into Camp Randall to take on John Clay and the Badgers Saturday night, 7 o'clock Eastern time. You can see it on ESPN, College Football Primetime, presented by Hampton Hotels. It's also available online and on your phone. Big, big challenge.
Wisconsin, big enough and physical enough on defense, I think, to take away the run game from Ohio State.
Yeah.
Can Terrell Pryor make the throws necessary to win on the road in a rocking environment like Camp Randall?
The green man showed up. Is that a USF?
I was going to assume that since we have a sea of gold here that the green guy made the trek from Tampa. Kickoff after the field goal. Noel Devine. Noel up across 25. And Geno Smith will have a first down opportunity here, and he has thrived throwing the football on first down.
Craig, we talked about this offense coming in, averaging over 6 yards on first down. Geno Smith, 9 for 10 in the first half when they've thrown the football downfield on that opening down.
And they've taken advantage at times, even like this one here on this touchdown to Devine, of a very aggressive USF defense who played well that first half. They just had that one play at the end that got them.
Touchdown tosses coming on first down. This time they'll keep it on the ground. Noel Devine, close to the 40, putting Washington on the stop.
Watch the right guard. It's going to pull and come around and clean house. Nice job. Open it up, Eric Jobe.
Devine has it again. Give a running room, and Noel knows when to give up on the play as we check in with Jen Brown.
We've been seeing Devine running the ball, and we talked earlier about the bone bruise that he had on his toe. I talked to the trainers to see what to look for, what would give him trouble tonight. They said lateral movements, no problem. Speeding up, slowing down, no problem. It's where he gets tangled up, where he gets tackled, and he's pushing for those extra yards that really can give him trouble with that injury.
He knew his journey was over there, Jen.
There comes a time, right?
Here comes a pressure look from USF.
Smith, Jock Sanders. He is knocked down immediately. An excellent play by Skinny Raymond.
He's so good close to the line of scrimmage because he's long, he's physical, very difficult to block at the point of attack. Just runs right by the wide receiver, able to get in the backfield, use those long arms for the tackle.
You know, he's a guy that previous assistant coach said that if he ever got into a game, he'd go to the sweet bay and get another sack and watch another game because he figured this one would be over. He was really calling out Raymond for his work habits, and he's really turned his career around. It's the cornerback that lets Mark Snyder sleep at night, he says. on third down. All kinds of time. Geno Smith down the middle. First down and the catch by Tavon Austin.
Geno Smith has an unbelievable amount of time to throw this football. Look at the pocket he has to throw into. Six yellow jerseys protecting. It's a three-man rush. He has about 7 seconds to throw that football.
There's just no way you can expect the defensive secondary to cover any of these receivers at West Virginia beyond 4 or 5 seconds.
29 on third and 17. You should not stand with that guy, Austin, that long. Devine. Slam down D.D. Lattimore.
One thing offensive coordinator Jeff Mullen from West Virginia is trying to do is create more balance. In the first half, they had thrown the ball 23 times, only run it 10. They were way too predictable. They're trying to run it more here early.
Well, Mark Snyder said, remember now, great defenses win games when you have to.
Another completion to Sanders.
And I sense that. You feel that urgency by that USF defense right now. They're playing hard. They played hard. They give up the long third down play. But first and second, they didn't give up. They got after it.
For momentum's sake, they would love to get a stop here, get the football back to kind of keep that momentum from their opening drive.
We got 29 on the last third and long. Smith, release, complete. Starts. Pushing forward, trying to get it, and it looks as if he's got enough for the first down.
I thought they changed something up here, Jesse. They just had a third down and long converted. They still only rushed four.
They use a return route by Brad Starks, the former quarterback. Looks like there's a face mask there they missed. That should be an extra 15 tagged on.
This one's done a good job here tonight. That's one they missed. Two straight third and long conversions, that time 14 yards. Mountaineers on the move. Give it to the big fella, Ryan Clark. He pounds down toward the 20, and he is the running back with some size and power. But Jeff Mullen says, gives us that toughness element that sometimes your spread teams lack in the running game.
Ryan Clark is 6 feet tall, but he weighs 250 pounds. And when West Virginia needs those hard-earned yards, they're going to run to the left. The left side of the offensive line is the strong side for West Virginia.
Second down and four.
You see him pat his center on the fanny, telling, hey, I'm going to change it. Don't just hang with me.
Again, it is Clark pounding his way forward for a couple of Lattimore again on the stop.
You know, Geno Smith, go back to the Marshall game. Two 90-something yard drives to overcome a 20-6 deficit. 8 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. He showed incredible poise there. It's been a carryover. This guy just plays well beyond his years of experience.
Those two drives were season savers. Let's not kid ourselves about what that game means in this state. Clark pushing ahead, first down, West Virginia. He ran behind Matt Lindemood as the big fellas moving the pile for West Virginia.
Here on this play, they go to a jumbo look. They're going to bring motion. They brought Matt Timmerman all the way across the formation before this run got started. They're finally able to give it to the big guy. They had an overload jumbo look on the right side. All of the weight on that side of the line. You factor in a 250-pound back, first down.
Clark has solved some of the short yardage situations that West Virginia had a couple of years ago. Got it again. Clark pushes it down close to the 10-yard line.
Down here in the red zone in the first half, you had the same feel going, and all of a sudden, what happened? Play action pass and a big touchdown to Brad Starks. That USF defense just kept getting up there, stopping the run, bang.
Defensive backs can be more aggressive because the windows to throw in down at this area of the field are a lot smaller. They'll bite on fakes.
Fifth straight carry for Clark inside the 10, running over defenders, and will finally be snowed under at about the 7-yard line. Jarrell Young, along with Lattimore.
For a 250-pound back, Ryan Clark has unbelievable feet and balance. And it's a nice change of pace for this running game.
It forces a defensive player who's been out there thinking, don't lose my balance, and fire at one of these shifty guys, right?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, now you got to bring your hammer with you and bring the wood to a ball carrier that's got 250 pounds and a lot of power. It's a great changeup.
Wouldn't be surprised here on third down if West Virginia tries to spit the football out to one of its playmakers in space. They're looking, this is another run formation.
And Geno better hurry or he's going to have to use a timeout. And just about got away from him. Some substitutions made. West Virginia uses the timeout to try to convert the third down when you come back.
ESPN's College Primetime, brought to you by Mazda, Zoom Zoom Forever, and Dr. Pepper. There's nothing like a pepper.
Very rich football heritage here in West Virginia. As you kind of look at KJ Harris and then Steve Slayton. Slayton part of a great explosive spread option offense that really vaulted West Virginia back into national prominence under Rich Rodriguez. And continuing here, trying to return to the winner's circle in the Big East after having Cincinnati win the conference the last 2 years. First Big East game of the season for West Virginia. They're up 17-6 on USF and looking at a third and four in the red zone. Geno Smith throwing to the end zone, incomplete. Almost had Jock Sanders. He's already caught 10 passes tonight.
Here's a play Geno Smith would like back. When he's scrambling out to the right-hand side, he's going to have Jock Sanders at the back. He's open right now. The ball's got to get to him early. He waits too long, floats it a little bit, but that's still probably a ball Jock Sanders should come down with.
And again, USF gets away with only rushing four. The play was there, but you just can't. Geno Smith has proven. You let him stand back there, and he's usually going to find the receiver.
Tyler Bittenkirk made one from 27. Now he'll try one from 24. Musket tells you that it's good. West Virginia answers the USF field goal, and B.J. Daniels will have a chance when you come back.
We have nothing for you.
You got nothing with a mirror full?
We're just two.
Some of the NASCAR parlay.
We're still going left.
Right blinker doesn't even work. Lindsey Lamar looking for a seam, gets across the 25 as we check in with John Saunders.
Reach time now for the AT&T All-America Player of the Week. And it's quarterback Taylor Potts out of Texas Tech. As they beat Baylor, he went 42 of 59 for 462 yards and four touchdowns as well. Don't forget to get involved. Text the word VOTE to 345-345 and have a chance to win a trip to the national championship.
Well, I tell you, John, watching that game Saturday, Texas Tech and Baylor running up and down the field. Robert Griffin had a chance to get his team even late. He's an exciting young quarterback for Baylor, and Potts is outstanding as well. B.J. Daniels going to take a deep shot. Evan Landy was running. Good coverage by Hogan.
West Virginia now defensively has decided to not allow USF to run the football anymore. They load the box. You get a chance to look here at B.J. Daniels last season in this game versus tonight. The big difference has been on the ground. 5 yards tonight running the football. Last season, they could not get him on the ground.
He had 9 carries tonight. He had 14 carries for those 104 yards last year, but many of his carries tonight have just been off a scramble, not many designed runs. Here is a scramble. Not much doing for B.J. again.
And they got it done that play with a three-man rush. They were rushing, but they were disciplined. You know, that defensive line, man, how about those guys led their 93, big Scooter Berry?
They contained the quarterback in the pocket. They did a great job not allowing him to get to the outside. That's how you can sack athletic quarterbacks. Keep them in that small 5-by-5 box.
Pass rush specialist. That man, number 11, Bruce Irvin, junior college transfer. Almost down like a sprinter. Here he comes. He's after Daniels. Irvin's got him. Crowd going Bruce. Bruce Almighty getting the sack.
Now, you know, this guy here is one of those former wide receivers turned defensive lineman. You just see how he's now got the hand swat. He's got the speed and the drive. No shot for that offensive lineman soon.
He's still very raw. The defensive coordinator, Jeff Castile, just tells him, hey, pin your ears back. Go find a white helmet behind the center and hit it.
Man.
Sack. Hanging the punt. And all kinds of issues trying to reel that thing in for Jock Sanders. The senior put it away.
Look at Charlie Huff knuckleball coming down.
Well, Jock had a big enough mitt, and Irvin makes a big play. And when you look at South Florida trying to get back into this game, what would you like to see them do more of as the final quarter and minute 54 left here in the third?
What they did on their opening drive. They were under center. They were aggressive. It looked like B.J. Daniels, when he came out, he came up decisively where he was going to throw the football, right? I mean, they ran it.
No, in this second half, it's looked like B.J. Daniels been trying to force the ball to Dontavia Bogan. He's got to let the coverage predict and dictate where he's throwing the football.
Hey, you know what? Let me ask you a question. Is there a receiver out there that we've seen tonight that gives you even the inclination or thought that maybe USF has an explosive guy?
No, but that's the problem, because it's not the same offense as last year when they had Carlton Mitchell, who's now playing in the National Football League, and all that other speed. They got former quarterbacks playing wide receiver. They got former running backs now playing wide receiver. It's a completely different scheme.
That number five, Lindsey Lamar, the kick return specialist, find a way. Get him in the game. Get the ball in his hands, which they wanted to do.
Was one of the offensive goals tonight. They tried to throw him some short screens, bubbles, things like that, but he's been unable really to get downfield to get much done.
On the flip side, guys, I'm very shocked West Virginia has not taken more shots deep downfield. They came into this game feeling like they had a huge speed advantage on the perimeter versus these DBs.
But the one thing Stu said we've never been able to consistently do is throw the ball. Tonight, those last drive, two big third down passes, they've consistently thrown it tonight.
A lot of the passes have been short, but yes. Smith has completed 13 of his last 14. Gino not going to get a chance this time. D.D. Lattimore.
That's an example there. If you're Geno Smith, I know on the last drive against the three-man rush on third down, he had 7 seconds, but you got to know the clock's going off in your head. Single safety, the wide-open receiver's on the right side of the screen.
You know what
you
he didn't
get
do?
Rid of that.
You know what he didn't do, though, Jesse? He didn't throw it away to somebody like B.J. Daniels did late in the second quarter.
Yeah.
Right?
Clock's got to
I hear
go
what
off.
You're
no,
saying.
No. Ball's got to come out. Yeah.
What are we, yeah at each other?
I'm agreeing with you.
I am with you, too. I am, too. Don't throw the pick six. Don't take a sack.
West Virginia is going to wait for the fourth quarter to punt it away as the Mountaineers sprint to the other end, up 20-6 as we head to the fourth. Headed to the fourth quarter in Morgantown. You see the officials are wearing a wristband tonight in support of their colleague Jim Smith. Smith, the field judge on this crew, was scheduled to work this game tonight, but he's been diagnosed with throat cancer. He began chemotherapy this week. One of the fine Big East officials who officiated the BCS championship game a year ago. We certainly want to send our best wishes and prayers out for Jim and hope that he will be able to fight against the throat cancer and have a full and speedy recovery and return to the field with his colleagues here, and they're showing their great support for him tonight. West Virginia about to punt it away on a 4th and 15. South Florida's been 7 quarters without an offensive touchdown and a bull touch it. Evan Landy wasn't sure, so he got on it very wisely, making sure that the Bulls will maintain possession.
Woo-hoo.
Very close. Ooh,
former quarterback there making a very smart heads-up play, getting down to the ball. The last thing that USF needed to do was allow the ball, this punt ball, to hit the ground. Misjudged
legal
on
formation
it.
On the kicking team. 5 yards will be added to the end of the run. First down.
I'm not sure Terrence touched it. The one thing with the two return men for South Florida, Terrence Milchill and Lindsey Lamar, great open field running instincts. But even in high school, they didn't really return kicks a lot. Not a lot of experience in terms of fielding the football.
Judging that ball as it comes down.
I think just the decision to try to field that right. ball was the wrong one there by Mitchell, and it almost cost him.
So B.J. Daniels brings out his offense, which has been unable to find the end zone seven quarters. This is from a guy who has been so explosive in his short career. Lamar has it. Lindsay up close to the 39-yard line. Saturday, ESPN and ABC team up to bring you two games nationwide at 3:30 Eastern time. Many will see number 5 Nebraska against Texas rematch of the Big 12 title game last year. Others will see Denard Robinson at Michigan against number 15 Iowa in that tough defense led by Adrian Claiborne. Both games available nationally on ESPN or ABC. It starts at 3:30 Eastern. Here's the zone read. Plant, you're keeping it up close to the first down. In fact, the way they're running across, it looks as if he got it, and he did.
I'm going to tell you what, Scooter Berry, 93, defensive end, West Virginia, better stay at home because he's collapsed completely inside. B.J. Daniels, all he has to do is read that, pull that football, and he's got a lot of carpet.
USF back to a different look on offense, going 3-by-1 in the shotgun, trying to spread out this 3-3-5 look from West Virginia.
Daniels over the middle, batted into the air. Brandon Hogan is the one who got a hand on it.
This is something that USF wanted to do on offense. They wanted to get Dontavia Bogan isolated to the near field in one-on-one coverage, and they wanted to throw him the route tree all night. Slants, comebacks, posts, go routes. But there's been a lot of safety help so far in this game. There haven't been a lot of chances for B.J. Daniels to go that way.
Second down and 10. Daniels getting everybody on the same page. And across the middle, Andy, and it's intercepted. Keith Tandy. Tandy with his fourth interception, and this has really become his specialty, catching the ball off a deflection.
Yeah, I think this is a ball here. When they go back and study film, they're trying to force this football in there. Number 2, you see underneath Sands, there's no room. There's no window for that ball.
Evan Landy has the best hands at wide receiver, according to B.J. Daniels. But B.J. Daniels had a wide-open receiver in the flat, forced that football over the middle. There was an easy completion to be had. And again, it results in another turnover.
Second interception of the night, 9th. Of the season already for B.J. Daniels. Well, Devine, other than the touchdown on the hook and lateral, rather quiet tonight. A short game.
You know, it's just another example of a young quarterback, you know, maybe trying to make too much happen. But I'll say this, B.J. Daniels comes over, taps his receiver on the head, showing a lot of leadership, a lot of composure here, because he wouldn't necessarily have done that last year, Craig.
Some of that, though, you got to put on the coaching staff, too. I mean, they see that. They see what we're seeing there. That zone reads down there. You know, don't ask your quarterback to make a great play like that.
Devine.
And I think that Skip, there's a lot of learning going on between Skip and Daniels and this football team still. You know, a lot of times you forget that when a new staff comes in, it takes time to adapt and learn, and it just you know, it's a new system, new scheme. There's the USF defense has it going on, the offense doesn't, but no surprise to us in our film study.
No. And defense can be reactionary, offense about execution, and up to this point in the season, South Florida has struggled with that execution. Noel Devine would have run a long way if not for D.D. Lattimore.
Go back and take a look at that interception for a minute and try to see what B.J. Daniels was looking at. He's trying to thread the needle over the football. It's a hard throw that probably should be caught, but you look at Skip Holtz looking at his quarterback. What were you looking at? What were you thinking about there? What's going on in your mind? There's a guy open down, you know, wide open on the sideline. Take the easy completion.
Smith has taken the easy completions. West Virginia has in mind to try to pound and bleed the clock with Ryan Clark. It's Craig Mitchell and Ryan Giddens. Craig Marshall, I should say, and Ryan Giddens on the stop.
You know, for the USF, I mean, Jesse, if you're really taking stock of this football program right now, don't you guys sit there and say, okay, we do have a defense. We're capable in the special teams. How do you simplify and get Daniels? Because you're building around him.
They've tried to simplify a lot already, and I think they're still learning about B.J. Daniels as the season goes on. What is he good at? What is he not good at? They haven't had a lot of time with him yet, and unfortunately, they're going to lose some games to figure it out.
Geno Smith, Austin, another catch. Another good play by Mr. Raymond.
Well, one thing that B.J. Daniels did, he had over 100 yards rushing against Florida. And there are only two quarterbacks who have done that since, like, 96.
He's the only player in Big East history to ever throw for over 300 yards and run for over 100 yards in the same game. So he has that athletic ability. How do you harness it if you're USF? He's a special player.
Game against Louisville last year when Daniels went off, and of course the upset victory. He led in Tallahassee last season against Florida State, had several big pass plays down the field, moved the chains with his feet. Get the feeling the confidence is wavering with B.J. at the moment. Geno Smith will go down. The South Florida's defense, Patrick Hampton on the stop, is fighting tooth and nail to try to give the Bulls chance after chance to get back in it.
Yeah, and Hampton is one of these guys they felt tonight would be a key player for them in space against this speedy West Virginia offense, and he showed up. His defense and this team, they should be proud of themselves. Mark Snyder, they'll pat them all on the fanny and tell them nice job.
This is a defense that lost four players to the NFL draft a year ago. They have talent. This defense will keep them in every game they play.
Isn't that amazing? You're right. They lost a lot of players.
Yeah.
And with Devine has been unable to find any running room at all. And West Virginia has not been able to run the ball effectively tonight. I'm totally relying on Geno Smith. Mitchell again played that thing like it had a pin in it. It was going to explode on him. But he makes the catch. South Florida will have it back. All right, we're getting Craig and Jesse all loosened up. Make sure the groin's ready, the hammy's nice and loose. What will they do for this week's workout in Morgantown?
Speaking of explode.
Back in Morgantown, West Virginia up by two touchdowns on South Florida, 20-6. You know, Craig and Jesse, they're like a number one team. They come into a hostile environment, people ready for them.
That's not how fast we're going. This is called Law School Hill. Strength coach Mike Joseph makes his players run up and down this long, steep hill. And Craig, it hurts a lot.
What's missing in this video? Where are you, Jesse?
I'm watching you.
This was unbelievable.
Bottom.
My fanny and my quads blew up. Mike Joseph, we had to get up there in less than 30 seconds. We did that, 24, 27, 27. And I'm telling you, I went and soaked in the 54-degree cold tub for 10 minutes. That was the hardest one yet for me.
We're going to have more on that in just a minute. First and 10, B.J. Daniels, the Bogan.
You know, walking down the hill after the second trip up, we're coming back down, and the strength coach Mike Joseph looks down on the ground. He says, hey, there's some remnants from a guy that just tried to run this. There was a pile of vomit on the grass, and at that point my will was crushed.
Don't you remember what I said to you before you started? I said, if you'll quit on that hill, you might quit on me. And I didn't see you in that last piece of video.
Well, I was going to walk out after this next series.
Oh, my goodness.
Finish, Jesse. Finish. Oh.
How about the camera guy, Shoop, getting up and down that hill with us? Unbelievable.
I appreciate them, you know, shooting this in super, super
look at that
fast
form.
Motion.
I'm all good there. But I'm telling you guys, the last 15, John Shoop, the last 15 yards of that
there
hill at the top. Good job,
John,
bro. Way to go.
Job. John carrying the camera, he said he'd do it a few more times if he had to. Mo Plancher, it was pulled out of his belly, and B.J. kept it on the zone read this time, and an open field tackle by Terrence Garvin.
Yeah, he's looking at his receiver telling him he wants a block. Now, I'd say, B.J., you get up the field, get north. That's not that receiver's fault. He's occupying his man. You get north.
You don't want to put too much criticism on Daniels. I understand it's a different system, but he just doesn't seem to be in rhythm. He doesn't seem to have a good feel at the moment. And the flat to Plancher.
B.J. Daniels admits that he's a freshman in this offense. This is his first year in this program as the full-time starter. And again, he's young. He played last year as a true freshman. So he's seen something for the first time each and every Saturday or each or every Thursday he plays.
Here we are again. 1 of 8 on third down tonight for USF.
Daniels needs 5 to keep the drive alive, and time is becoming a big enemy of the Bulls. DJ didn't get rid of it. It'll be fourth down.
Just in a different look. Again, this West Virginia defense, very smart. One's going to pull out. You're going to come in here, and you're going to bring 4 guys at them. So it's just different looks on what they're giving. B.J. Daniels.
They try to confuse this offensive line with all that movement before the snap. It takes one lineman to miss his assignment, and it leads to a sack.
And I thought, watching with you guys in the film study, the O-line slide protection against Syracuse was poor. You know, they feel like they would love to play that game again, but just didn't get it done.
That's Julian Miller, the junior defensive end from Columbus, Ohio. Very strong as a pass rusher. Become a leader on this defensive front for Jeff Castile, who's really put together an underrated defensive unit.
It just goes to show you how lethal this 3-3-5 scheme can be, both against the run and the pass. You're only playing with 3 down linemen. A lot of the times, it's a 6-man box, but here they are again. They've given up only 65 rushing yards tonight, and they're able to get pressure on the quarterback. They had 8 sacks against Maryland early in the season. They're getting after a very athletic quarterback again tonight.
Saw Jeff Castile there. They've held three of four opponents under 250, and tonight it's only 166.
South Florida forced to punt it away again. Sanders covered up immediately. So just under 7.5 to play. South Florida will have to come up with another stop and try to get it back in a hurry. They trail by 2 touchdowns. We're in the homestanding West Virginia Mountaineers up 20-6. Mountaineers haven't mounted a lot of offense in the second half. Only a field goal, and SportsCenter is coming up as soon as her beloved Mountaineers finish off this game, they hope, with a victory against South Florida. Geno Smith. We'll throw it away.
One thing West Virginia head coach Bill Stewart has been accused of in the past is not winning with style points. Here they are, 20-6. Do they put their foot down on the pedal, or are they content to take this lead to the end?
I think he's looking at the big picture. Style points and positioning in the polls doesn't matter to him. Win the Big East. You're going to a BCS Bowl, right? He's not going to play for a national championship. Just get to a BCS Bowl game.
Mountaineers have won a couple of those in their history. Of course, Stewart's first game as the interim coach. That's the most important bowl victory in school history against Oklahoma in the Fiesta Bowl.
Bill Stewart has told us in the past, he doesn't look for knockouts. He doesn't need a technical knockout. He looks for split decision wins. Yeah. He just likes the W.
7 rounds is what he says. We're in round 1. Let's go knock them out and let's get it done. And let's don't blink. That's his other saying. Don't blink. Stay focused.
Have some boxing gloves hanging in places around the football facility to help remind the Mountaineers of his metaphor of the 7-round fight. Round 1 is going West Virginia's way so far. Smith on 3rd and 5. Austin with the catch and a sure tackle by Mistral Raymond, who has played an excellent game. Weir is being marked to be a yard short of the first down, so Raymond is going to give the Bulls another chance to get the football. As you take a look at what the Mountaineers have in front of them, the loss at LSU, West Virginia felt as if they really had a chance to win in Tiger Stadium on a Saturday night. They had some miscues. They gave up a punt return, a touchdown, which a lot of people do, to Patrick Peterson. But what lies ahead looks very manageable for West Virginia.
But we will, I think, all agree that they have the ability, the potential to lose a number of those opponents we thought would be good.
Pittsburgh certainly hasn't performed to the standard we'd expect. Louisville, under Charlie Strong in his first year, better than expected, and could continue to improve over the course of the season.
Don't count out UConn. You never know.
Of course not. Always a tough-minded team are the Huskies. A little toughness needed from the 5:46 remaining in Morgantown. West Virginia band striking up a winning tune. Mountaineers on top 20-6, largely behind a splendid defensive effort. West Virginia's held South Florida to just 166 yards of offense. Sacked B.J. Daniels four times, picked him off twice. But still enough time if South Florida will get busy in a quick completion to Dontavia Bogan.
But they need a touchdown on this drive. They need to march this football down the field. They have all three of their timeouts, but they have to work efficiently, pick the tempo up. You're in two-minute mode right now offensively for South Florida.
It has to be to the outside because with this 3-3-5, you're going to have a lot of defenders in the middle of the field.
Straight completions to Bogan. Bogan slips a tackle and puts his way out of bounds. Sidney Glover pushing him out.
Looks a little decisive sometimes, doesn't he? I mean, he's got a lively arm, and you see the potential. This is one of those players that you probably get frustrated trying to coach, trying to figure out the button to push.
All the fundamentals are there. There is no question about it. He can throw the football. He just needs more time in the system.
Headed toward 5 minutes to go. Daniels, right through the hands of his receiver, Stephen Bravo Brown.
You know what else he needs, Reese? Receivers.
Yeah. That's a big difference. And, you know, that's something that certainly he had last year. He had an NFL-caliber guy in Carlton Mitchell. We talked about all the different receivers he has now that used to be playing different positions. And he's not working with a full deck. And it's going to get better because the talent gets better around him. Right now, Dontavia Bogan, you see right there, is his best receiver.
Also lost A.J. Love and Sterling Griffin to injuries. He certainly could have helped the cause. Daniels now using the athleticism. A.J. still on his feet, and he gets into Mountaineer territory. Very short gain. It'll bring up a third down. And USF has converted just one time tonight on third down.
As this West Virginia defense makes this football team. You know, I read these stack of articles that we prepared for this game. Everybody wants to talk about the offense at West Virginia, and I understand that. It's explosive, but it's the defense.
Defensive coordinator Jeff Castile is one of the best-kept secrets in America, period.
Third down. Ooh. And movement along the offensive front.
Ball start. 63 offense. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
There's Jamar Bass. Left tackle.
This is four down territory right now for USF. You look at what West Virginia's been able to do defensively tonight.
Wow.
A lot of action behind the line of scrimmage. 9 tackles for loss, 4 sacks. The athleticism up front. The speed at the second level at the linebacker position, they're lethal.
Third and 13. Daniels turns it loose, it's intercepted again. Third pick of the night for the Mountaineer defense.
JT Thomas, number 30, sat in the middle of the football field. He's going to sit right back here, and why? He's just going to spy. I'm going to watch where you're going. I'm hanging with you, BJ. I'm in your pocket. And then the forced throw to the middle of the field. There's just too much yellow there.
BJ Daniels does everything right on this play. He's able to break, contain, get to the perimeter of the football field, but he has to be aware that defenders in zone coverage are watching his eyes.
The guy who got it was Brantwon Bowser. Kid out of Phoenix who had an ACL injury in 2008, ruptured appendix that caused him to miss a year, and making his first significant contribution as a Mountaineer this year, and he comes up with what could be the game-sealing interception for West Virginia. Saturday night, the new number one team in the land, Ohio State, going on the road to Camp Randall to take on Wisconsin. Now, ninth road game in the Big Ten. Means Ohio State's got them right where they want them. They won the last 5, have lost in such circumstances since the 2005 trip to Penn State. Can Wisconsin change that? You can see Saturday at 7 o'clock Eastern on ESPN. College Football Primetime presented by Hampton Hotels. You can see it online and on your phone as well.
Wisconsin's rush defense, only 1 on the ground allowed this year for a touchdown. They're going to show up.
Ryan Clark. Mountaineers, the ball comes loose, but the officials blowing it dead.
In the big picture, South Florida has to get better playing in conference. Since being in the Big East now for a little over 5 years, they've been great out of conference. 23-5 record in those games. They get up for Florida State, Auburn a few years ago, Kansas a few years ago. But look what they've done in conference. They're 17-19 playing inside the Big East. They have the talent to compete. But they need to turn this thing around. Their best finish in Big East play is a 4-3 record.
I think Skip Holtz is the guy. It's, you know, Skip's been around. He knows what to do. He'll recruit. He'll get the players in here. He'll get B.J. Daniels on track. And when that happens, when they're building the team around that guy. So it's just taking time.
You know, Skip Holtz is figuring out what he needs to compete inside conference play. This is only his second conference game, you know, here, but he's playing against the cream of the crop tonight.
Yes, he is.
And he'll find out how he matches up.
This game spun on one play at the end of the second quarter, right before the halftime. You know, he's thrown three picks, but the one going in with a minute plus before halftime, rolling, and he sees he's late. He's tardy. The receiver's there. He throws it behind the receiver. And for West Virginia, their secondary has watched his eyes, you pointed out, Jesse, and they've made plays.
This game has been a battle of two young quarterbacks. Both B.J. Daniels and Geno Smith are both true sophomores. Geno Smith is comfortable in his system. B.J. Daniels is not yet comfortable in his system. Their play demonstrates that. Certainly the numbers demonstrate that. And that's the big advantage West Virginia has right now.
Sometimes when a quarterback would give to Matt Lindemood, the quarterback is called a game manager. Sometimes it can be viewed as a, you know, I guess condemning someone with faint praise. But while Geno Smith has some extraordinary talent, that's the difference at the moment between Smith and B.J. Daniels. Smith's able to manage the game, and Daniels is struggling with that.
Consistent coaching staff, too. I just can't say enough about that. We've got a first-year staff. Holtz is putting together. You've got Stewart on the other sidelines with the staff together. This family's been together now. They know what they're doing.
B.J. Daniels under the tutelage of Todd Fitch, the offensive coordinator, who is in the press box, and Peter Bonds, the quarterback coach. As you guys were talking about, Skip Holtz, a proven commodity in terms of turning programs around. When he arrived at East Carolina, Pirates at that point had lost 22 of their previous 25 games in the last 2 years. They were Conference USA champions.
You know, and I want to give B.J. Daniels some credit here. This game has not gone the way he would have liked. He's thrown three interceptions. He's very competitive. A season ago, guys, we saw him as a freshman lose his temper, lose his focus at times, yelling at receivers. He'd sit by himself down the bench, isolated from his team. He understands as he keeps playing, his leadership will be defined in a lot of different aspects.
Well, South Florida is going to have success on offense this season. They have to have B.J. Daniels be productive. They don't have another option at quarterback, and his talent is something that has to be used.
But that's such a good point you make, Jesse, about just corralling first and foremost the emotions of B.J. Daniels. And that's just outstanding coaching. It's mentoring. Because if you don't have him under control emotionally, you're not going to get him going.
But a lot of it is because of B.J. Daniels himself, too. He's been able to center himself, focus himself. He's going to learn from this game. He'll learn from these performances. I still believe he's going to be a great college quarterback. He has an opportunity.
Hey, and you know what? At the end of the day, don't you say, Reese, if you're Skip, don't you tell him and tell B.J., we just played a good football team on the road. We played a good team, a couple plays here and there, three interceptions, but the one going in at half. Or this is a good, different complexity.
Yeah, it certainly changed the complexion, and largely the complexion was changed all night by the West Virginia defense. You can pick a lot of guys for the Wranglers. Five-star player of the game, but Keith Tandy's going to get it. Double figures in tackles. He forced a fumble and also caught the interception off the deflected pass. Keith Tandy, our Wrangler five-star player of the game.
Keith Tandy was a guy that defensive coordinator Jeff Castile was a little bit worried about. He was worried that this South Florida offense might take a lot of deep shots on him. He's given up some big plays in the past, gave up two long touchdowns against USF last year and a 96-yard touchdown against Marshall earlier in the year, but he stepped up tonight big.
He had two interceptions against UNLV last week, another one tonight, so hats off to Tandy.
And big plays have been an Achilles heel for West Virginia. They'd given up touchdown passes of 80 and 60 to Maryland, 96 to Marshall. West Virginia's going to move up the rank. You don't know if they're going to approach the top 10 just yet, but this is what the AP top 10 has in store.
Who in there you thinking has a chance there this week? Who's on our upset alert? Is it Nebraska and Texas? Is it Nebraska?
I think it's the team sitting beside the number one. I think they got to be very careful. This is a very interesting matchup at a very hostile environment. I think we're going to find out a lot about just how good Ohio State is.
I think number seven better be careful, too, because as good as Auburn is, I would say the one thing is that they can give up yardage passing. And here comes old Ryan Legend in there to pitch that pill around Jordan-Hare Stadium.
He's a legend.
Better be careful.
And Auburn's just been living on the edge.
But you know,
it's a little bit dude.
But you know what happens is West Virginia downs the punt. I think a lot of times when you have teams like Auburn and LSU who have lived on the edge, there comes a point in the season when that perceived weakness, if you want to call it that, or scraping by, almost becomes a strength. I mean, Auburn, for instance, do you really think if they're down late, they don't believe with their whole heart that Cameron Newton's going to make a play?
Absolutely. And you know, believe it. Absolutely. If you got Cam Newton on your sidelines, you know the guy is going to pick you up somehow, whether it's arms or his legs.
Good teams find ways to win games. And this is a team that beat Mississippi State by 3 points. They had to go to overtime to beat Clemson. They beat Kentucky on a last-second field goal. They found ways, and Cam Newton's really been the difference. He's got an opportunity in this game against Arkansas not just to do something big for the team, but to do something big individually in terms of his Heisman chances.
And freshman Bobby Evelyn has checked in at quarterback for South Florida for the final minute of the game. And I think you're right about the Heisman chances. You know, the one thing that I think goes really, we saw it in the game against Mississippi State. It's not the 70-yard runs or the long passes that Cam Newton makes. It's the place where the defense has every receiver blanketed, and they also have Newton contained on a 3rd and 5, and he still gets 6.
We saw That's it on that Thursday night, Reese, when he ran over a couple of guys for those hard 4 and 5 yard runs. I think he realized that night how powerful and explosive he could be.
Cameron Newton is right up there with Terrell Pryor in terms of his ability to convert third downs running the football in any sort of situation. I mean, he's big time.
Be important for both of those guys to do that in their respective games. Newton at home against Arkansas and Pryor on the road on ESPN Saturday night against Wisconsin. As we get down to the final half minute of what's going to be West Virginia's first Big East victory, and South Florida is going to fall to 0-2 in conference play after losing Saturday against Syracuse.
From a conference standpoint, though, the Big East, they need their flag bearer. They need a team like West Virginia now to keep running and going and give them credibility.
Clock winding down. Evelt will get off one more play. He throws it into traffic, and let's see if they will not give him the last interception. But it was a stop nonetheless, and a brilliant performance by the West Virginia defense and a solid performance by the young quarterback Geno Smith. And Bill Stewart goes to 1-0 in the conference, getting a victory over Skip Holtz and South Florida.